Today we'll show you the foods that will re-energize you on hot and sweaty summer months. Unique and unusual vitality foods, which will pick up your body and get your appetite back. We'll show you the slithery king cobra dishes of Indonesia and the ant egg dish of Mexico, which pops into your mouth. We'll also show you the popular Filipino vitality food, balut, and the vitality jelly of Hong Kong, made from an ingredient beyond your wildest imagination. Let's begin our show of vitality foods that will blow this summer heat away. The first place we visit to taste a vitality food is here in Indonesia. Because of the intense sun, the people here have to fight the heat all year long. Because Indonesia has a tropical climate, which maintains 28 to 30 degrees Celsius all year long, it is common for people to get exhausted by the heat. For these people, vitality foods are essential.
I always eat nutritious vitality foods once or twice every year. I'll recommend something for you, so why don't you give it a try?
We'll ask around to find this famous restaurant. So, what's on the menu here?
I come here whenever I feel weak. Since you're here, why don't you give it a try?
I usually don't eat this, but I've got the courage to come here. I can't wait to eat the food. I'm also a little apprehensive.
Here's a king cobra. This scary king cobra is the main ingredient here. What kind of dish will be made from this? We hold our breaths in anticipation.
The ingredient isn't the only thing that will surprise you. You'll be surprised by the taste as well. It's very good.
The meat of the cobra, of which the poison has been removed, is covered in flour and deep fried. This meat is then fried once more with soy sauce to finish the king cobra goreng. If you throw away your prejudice, your mouths will begin to water. This is an even tastier delicacy made from king cobras. King cobra meat is cooked with vegetables and seasoned with soy sauce. Then it is boiled over a medium fire for about 2 minutes to finish the savory king cobra soup. The strong and poisonous flavor has been made mild into this dish. Finally, it's time to try the king cobra dishes. She bravely tries the king cobra soup.
This soup is very mild. This would be perfect when you've lost your appetite.
Next, how about the king cobra goreng?
Yeah, it's very chewy and savory. If you don't eat this because you're scared, you'll regret it.
The king cobra is a slightly expensive vitality dish, not easily affordable. Next, we'll try a vitality dish that can be easily enjoyed on the streets for a small amount of money. This woman appears on the street with quite a large load. Can you tell us what this is?
Oh, this is a jamu drink. I've been selling this for 10 years now, and everyone who drinks it says they have more energy.
Jamu is a medicinal herb that is grown in Indonesia. The jamu is mixed with ginger and another herb called kunyit to complete the drink. One glass is enough to fight the heat and fatigue.
If you drink a glass of this in the morning, you'll be refreshed. I always drink this in the morning.
The place that we visited to find our next vitality food is the country of the sun, Mexico. The alleys are full of delicious aromas. Mexico is among the countries with the most diverse foods in the world. So, do Mexicans also enjoy vitality foods?
Vitality food? Of course we have it.
The dish that I'll show you today is made from ant eggs. It's something that can't be tasted anywhere else. So, have a taste here.
They say that a long time ago, the Indians here enjoyed this dish. Eggs, which have to be scraped out of an ant mound, are one of Mexico's most expensive ingredients and are rich in vitamins and protein.
The ant eggs are fried in a preheated pan with olive oil. The important thing is to fry the eggs without popping them.
Ant egg dishes are known to be the perfect kind of vitality food for children and the elderly alike. Now the fantastic vitality dish that will pop in your mouth is complete. It's reasonable to be surprised. But the important thing is the taste. The people who've started eating with a scowl on their faces slowly start to smile.
Of course I thought it would taste strange, but the more you eat, the tastier it gets. And plus, I feel re-energized already.
Hong Kong is a paradise for food. They believe that nutritious food is the best medicine here, and it is because of this that the health foods here have become so developed. We were wondering what this group of people in the park was doing, and it turns out that they were practicing Tai Chi. Tai Chi is an exercise that loosens the joints and muscles, and it is this scene that shows the enormous interest the people of Hong Kong have in health.
Of course exercise is important, but I think that health truly starts with healthy eating.
Of the health foods that the people of Hong Kong eat, this food in the golden pot draws the most attention. What is the identity of the food hiding in this pot that they say is the secret to the health of the people of Hong Kong? We've decided to take a closer look. The thing that we see underneath the pot is a live turtle. They say this is the ingredient hiding in the golden pot. The turtle is the greatest vitality food of the people of Hong Kong.
We boil the live turtles for 8 hours, and then the broth becomes gelatinous.
They say that the jelly made from turtles tastes a lot like Chinese medicine. The turtle jelly has been loved here for more than 80 years, and because it is made with 13 other medicinal ingredients, it is full of rejuvenating nutrients. It is loved by young and old alike. This is an alley that sells dried seafood in Hong Kong. Hong Kong is a country of gourmets, and it is maybe because of this that the stores here are filled with seafood that isn't easily found anywhere else. From shark's fin, which is a popular ingredient of the cuisine here, to expensive dried abalone, there are many varieties of seafood in this place. Among the many ingredients of this place, the most popular is the swallow's nest. The swallow's nest is made from the secretions that come from the throat of a sea sparrow, and it is rich in nutrients like protein and calcium. Why is the sparrow's nest a little different in color?
The red sparrow's nest is made when the sparrow coughs up blood while making the nest. That's why this looks different.
A dish made from sparrow's nest uses papayas, melons, fruit jelly, peanuts, mayonnaise, and mustard sauce.
The highlight of the dish is the sparrow's nest. It is soaked in water and mixed.
When soaked in water, the sparrow's nest becomes 20 times larger. Because the actual sparrow's nest doesn't have any flavor, it is sweetened with sugar and other sweet ingredients. Then succulent lobster meat is added, and everything is topped off with more sparrow's nest to create the nutritious and delicious sparrow's nest salad.
What do you think? Doesn't it look delicious?
The place that we went to next in search of our final vitality food is the Philippines. What is this man selling so late in the evening?
Look, look, look.
Let's take a look.
Oh.
We carefully open the bag. Although they look like eggs, ballots are duck eggs that have been boiled just before hatching.
Oh, balutes are my favorite snack. I eat at least one every day.
By shelling an egg, we are able to confirm that it is a real duck boiled just before hatching. So, how will it taste?
Well, it's delicious and great for your stamina.
To find out how ballot is made, we visited a duck hatching facility.
This is where we incubate the eggs. Look around slowly.
They artificially incubate duck eggs here. They don't completely hatch the eggs, but only incubate the eggs for 10 days before selling them.
I'm checking the eggs to see if they're incubating properly.
It's essential to maintain the suitable amount of light and the right temperatures. So, what's inside the eggs?
If the dark object inside the egg moves, that means it's alive. But if it doesn't, that means it's dead.
You can see the difference between the ballot and normal eggs when they're broken, and they also have a difference in nutrition. Ballot is the most popular vitality food of the Philippines, and there is an old woman who is famous for her boiled ballot eggs.
I've been selling balut since I was 10.
Now we'll show you how to boil ballot with this lady who has been doing it for 50 years. The eggs are washed and boiled with salt.
It's important to control the fire and the time. I learned this from my mother.
Another important point in boiling ballot is to move the boiled eggs to an insulated basket quickly before they cool. This is because ballot tastes best when eaten hot. The care of 50 years know-how of this old lady makes her ballots quite popular here. The old lady leaves her house with a careful insulated ballot in order to sell them. Will they sell well today?
The ballots that I sell always sell out quickly.
Many people gather around to buy the ballots. With all this popularity, it wouldn't be an exaggeration to say that ballots are responsible for the health of the Filipino people. Although it may seem easy to eat the eggs, there is a special way to eat them.
It's delicious.
All right, take a close look at me. I'll show you how to eat balut.
First, the top shell is removed and the juices are sucked, along with some salt. Then the rest of the contents of the eggs are also eaten, seasoned with the salt. This is the true way to eat ballot.
Did you see what I did? Don't spill any juices when you eat them. You have to eat it like this to become revitalized. Stay healthy.
In every country, there are many unique and unusual vitality foods. Although they all differ in taste and ingredients, they are all made by people who value your health.
Let's look at the traditional costumes of the world. We'll show you people who cool the heat with clothing. We'll show you the traditional Egyptian galabia, the longi of Bangladesh, and the sulu of Fiji. We'll show you the sights of men who live in dresses. We'll also show you the layer after layer of the traditional abaya that the women of Qatar hide in. And we'll see the áo dài, which is the symbol of the beauty and mystery of Vietnamese women. Let us go to see traditional costumes of the world, full of history, religious tradition, and the essence of everyday life. Egypt, located in the northeast corner of the African continent, is also known as the Gift of the Nile. It is a typical Muslim country with over 90% of the population practicing Islam. The 10 Muslim temples in the city of Cairo are always full of people who are praying. This may be the reason that there is a site here that catches the eye of any foreigner. It is the site of the traditional Islamic clothes that the people who have come here to pray are wearing.
Look, camera!
What are you wearing now?
All Muslims wear this kind of clothing. It's tradition.
Some young people don't like to wear them, but they're clothes have been with us through tradition and history. These clothes are well ventilated.
The distinctive feature of these traditional clothes called galabia is that they are quite wide and long.
They're very comfortable.
Now, what kind of clothes do Egyptian women wear? Looking at the women here, we can see that the fabric covers their entire bodies, with only their faces showing. Their clothes are as unusual as the man's.
What do you think? It was commanded by Allah through the Quran that we wear these clothes. It covers the upper body.
This is a symbol of refinement for women here.
This is Qatar, located on the Persian Gulf, east of the Arabian Peninsula. What will the traditional clothing be for this country that isn't very well known to us? Like Egypt, Qatar is also a Muslim nation, and most of the women here are also well covered. They are wrapped all around by black cloth, and only their eyes peep out of their clothing. It may look stuffy, but it is everyday wear for the women here.
It's all right, I'm used to it. It's nice because it blocks the sun and sand.
According to our religious code, it's not allowed for women to bare themselves in public. That is why no matter the time or the place, women usually keep themselves covered. It's a symbol of their faith.
This is Abu Hamur Street in Qatar. The Thursday and Friday markets here are similar to that of outdoor markets in Asia. Because Friday is a day of rest in Islam, they hold the market like this on every Thursday and Friday here. There is almost nothing you can't find here. The most popular item amongst the women here is the traditional clothing called the ubaya. Each ubaya is a little different in its design and materials. And it is these traditional clothes that are used to cover the faces and bodies of the women here. The man shows ubayas to our curious eyes and even shows us the traditional way to put them on. After covering the face with the black veil, it is securely tied. Then the chest is covered with cloth. And finally, the entire body is covered in cloth once more. Isn't it quite difficult to wear?
Oh, that style is very popular with the customers here. It suits you very well.
How does it feel?
Oh, it's very stuffy. It may be different if you were born here. Maybe it's because it's my first time, but I feel stuffy. I think it'll be quite hot here in the summer.
Now, what do the women wear at home?
Women cover their faces in front of strangers. Even though young people sometimes expose themselves like this. This is my wife. She's given me 5 children and they're all beautiful like her.
The smiling faces of the women who've taken off their black veils give a bright impression different from what the traditional clothes would seem to indicate. But this long-standing tradition cannot be changed easily. The lady of the house keeps her veil on even when she's cooking. Now look at this. She even covers herself when she tastes her food.
It's delicious.
She won't take the veil off in front of strangers, even if I tell her to. Dear, why don't you show them your face? You can't tell because of the veil, but she's quite beautiful.
It can be uncomfortable at times, but when I'm covered, I feel that Allah is watching over me.
Another place that can't be missed if you want to see unique traditional clothing is Bangladesh, located on the upper part of the Ganges River. There are over 230 rivers all over the country. And people who are tired of the high temperatures and humidity happily jump into the river.
Even though it's hot, it's all right because it rains a lot.
They say that there is another way that the optimistic people of Bangladesh cool themselves. It is by wearing the traditional sari, which lets the cool breeze in. The sari, which is made from a long cloth, normally 5 to 6 meters in length, is worn by wrapping the cloth around the body. It is cool and also draws attention with its pretty colors and patterns.
These clothes don't need to be stitched. They're just made from a single piece of cloth that is wound around the body. Clothes that haven't been stitched are a symbol of purity.
Also, because there aren't many baths, many men here take their shirts off and jump in as soon as they see water. Although it is a poor country, as the smiles of the people here indicates, it is also a country that has the highest national happiness index in the world. So tell us, why do you take all your clothes off to wash instead of keeping your bottoms on?
In this country, even close friends are not allowed to be completely naked in front of each other.
These are the clothes that the men here wear. They're easy to take off and put on.
The longi, which is the traditional costume of the men here, is simply a piece of cloth that has been stitched into a shape no different from a dress. A unique method is used to put them on. The longi is folded like this, and the folded skirt is tucked inside the skirt, and the folded shirt is tucked inside the skirt.
Oh wow, it won't come off even if you tug it? Do you wear underwear with this?
No underwear. This acts as underwear. This acts as the underwear.
Of course, no underwear. It seems as if the man is embarrassed by not having any underwear on, and he begins to take out his frustration on the cow. We won't embarrass you anymore. Next is on to Fiji in the South Pacific. Walking around in this country, there is a sight that keeps catching our eye. It is the men around here that seem to be wearing skirts. Here's a skirt, and there's a skirt as well. Do all the men in this country wear skirts?
This is slightly embarrassing.
We find out that in Fiji, wearing these skirts is seen as formal and well-mannered as wearing suits. The traditional clothes of Fiji, called sulus, are also a way for the men here to cool themselves. Have you forgotten something by any chance?
No underwear.
They are truly brave men in skirts. Vietnam is a country that is located on the eastern coast of the Indochina Peninsula. It is a country that is 329,560 square kilometers in size, with a bustling population of 81 million people. One of the sights that can be commonly seen here is of women who are wearing the traditional costume of this country. One of the first things that comes to mind when you think of Vietnam is the áo dài. The áo dài, or long dress, originated from China and is being used even today as everyday wear. The sight of beautiful Vietnamese women wearing the áo dài leaves quite an impression. Although they're becoming more difficult to find these days, still, áo dài shops can be found fairly easily in Vietnam. There was a time when the lavish multicolored clothes were banned because they were said to be too suggestive.
Take a look at this.
Is this one that came out recently?
These are all new products.
Miss, are you going to have an áo dài tailor-made?
Yes, I have an important occasion coming up. Can I look at something else?
Okay.
I'll take this. Make me a pretty áo dài with this.
Step over here so that I can take your measurements.
Next, measurements are taken. Because the true charm of the áo dài lies in the fact that it fits closely to the body, áo dài cannot be ready-made. To tailor-make áo dài, over 20 measurements must be taken. It's quite difficult to get a dress made. Oh, there is one more measurement that needs to be taken. The measurements are carefully recorded. Then it is time for the veteran tailor, who has been making áo dài's from childhood, to take over. Although the work seems to be done in haste, the skill of the tailor is soon revealed. The linen is neatly cut in minutes.
It's my turn to work on the dress now. The áo dài must be cut and sewed precisely. It takes quite a bit of work to make.
Finally, the old lady, who has been making áo dài for her entire life, finishes off the dress. After 2 hours, the áo dài is completed.
It's finished. Now I'll try it on.
We'll reveal the Vietnamese áo dài in all its splendid beauty in a second. Although the dress looks simple, the fact that it is difficult to wear and take off shows the honest and stubborn character of the Vietnamese people.
Do you like it?
Yes, it's very pretty.
At times they are a continuation of a brilliant history, and at other times they are a symbol of deep religiosity, and sometimes they are just worn for their comfort. But traditional costumes have been a continual part of people's lives for thousands of years, and in them you can find the fragrant traces of humanity.
Billion people live in China. Because so many people live in the vast land, there are many things to see and many unusual people who surprise those around them. There is Asia's tallest person, who is close to 3 meters in height, as well as a kettle boy who can perform all kinds of amazing tricks with a tea kettle. Let's take a look at the unusual people of China who lead even more unusual lives. Where in this large country shall we go in search of unusual people? This is Wuhan City, that is located in Hubei in the heart of China. They say that there is someone who is well known by all of the locals here.
Just looking at him is amazing.
You'll find him over that way. I've never seen anyone like him in my life.
The person that greets us is the wife of the unusual man.
He's over there.
We finally get to meet the man that we've been searching so hard for. This incredibly tall person is the person that we've been looking for. This is the tallest person in Asia. Chung Jun-kei sways precariously as he walks, not able to manage his incredible height. Watching him sit on the sofa makes us even more cautious of his enormous figure. Because he is Asia's tallest man, even the size of his hands are quite shocking. Putting his wife, Yen Su-chin's, hand on his makes her hands look like that of a child. His gigantic hand is enough to cover her entire face. Jung Jun-kei's height started to grow rapidly when he was 18 years old. You can see how tall he is, even better with a person standing next to him. RPD, who is 180 centimeters in height himself, looks quite small next to him.
No matter how tall a person is, if he stands next to me, he'll look small. As you can see, my legs are longer than most people's height.
At our request, Jung Jun-kei shows us his room. His height makes it a difficult task to stand and sit down. Watching him carry his enormous stature, lumbering around the room, we find that he looks quite burdened. He leads us to his bedroom. His wife takes out his enormous pants and shows them to us. The length of the pants equals the height of a normal adult. All of Jung Jun-kei's clothes have been specially ordered to fit him.
This is my bed. It's a little big.
At first, we can't tell exactly how big it is, but we have the answer when we lie in it. This bed was also specially made to order and is 50 centimeters longer than normal beds. Now, this looks like the shoe cabinet. Can we take a look? But where are all of your shoes?
His shoes are so large they don't fit in here. That's why they're kept over there.
These are the shoes of the tallest man in Asia. Virtually the size of aircraft carriers, they have enough room for more than 1 foot each. They say that Jung Jun-kei's feet are 400 millimeters in length. Jung Jun-kei decides to go out with his wife. Because of his giant height, every time he moves his legs to take a step seems to be an enormous burden on him. His height, that seems to be almost as tall as that of a telephone pole, shocks people wherever he goes. When he gets in a car, his height requires him to fold his legs in an uncomfortable manner. And because of this, it is impossible for him to even think of going on long trips. This is also the reason that a foray out of his house is a big occasion for him. He and his wife head out into the city. He gets out of the car with difficulty, and the sight of him walking looks quite arduous. By the time that he reaches the store that he was looking for, a crowd of onlookers gathers around him. The people who have discovered the giant that they've only heard through rumors gather around him in seconds, straining to get a better look at his enormous height. By the expressions of awe on the faces of onlookers, we can guess how famous Jung Jun-kei must be around here. He doesn't seem bothered by the onlookers, as he seems to be concentrating on the tea that he is drinking. One of the hobbies that he enjoys most is drinking tea. That's why he has much interest in tea sets as well. His wife, who he met at work and married, is a passionate lover of tea as well.
It's delicious.
It's difficult to come here, and since we've found something that we like, let's take it home with us.
There is a bustling army of people outside of the store trying to get a look at the famous giant. Some in the crowd make fun of him and say abusive things, and this angers the gentle giant. His outing has become ruined, and the couple leave hurriedly in a cab to escape their home.
This is why I don't like to leave home.
This isn't the first time this happened. This happens every time we go out.
I don't mind them staring at me, but I can't stand their abusive comments.
This is why Jung Jun-kei's only true hobby can be watching television. Except for the occasional times that he appears on television programs or commercials, he spends most of his time at home.
Because of my height, there aren't many things that I can do. And it's difficult for me to move.
Although Jung Jun-kei is quite famous, his life is full of difficulties that normal people can never understand. This is Beijing, the capital of China. This is a place that has numerous tourist destinations. If you go to the busy Wangfu Jing Street, you'll find it bustling with people and products that show the culture and heritage of China.
Now take a look. I've detached these rings that were connected. I have a lot of skill, don't I?
Of all the interesting sights to see, the pretty tea kettles draw our attention the most. So, this is a tea kettle too. We checked to be sure, and it's true. It's a very unique tea kettle.
Doesn't it look interesting? A lot of customers buy this.
Of the many people that can be seen around this area, there's a figure that especially catches our eye. This person, seen walking bearing tea kettles on his shoulders, is a kettle boy!
Tea kettles are how I make my living.
Your living?
Yes. I make money with this.
He says that he makes his living using the tea kettles. Now, why don't we follow him to find out what he does with them? This is a restaurant in the middle of Beijing. With steaming steamboats in front of them, the guests are lost in the pleasure of eating. While the guests dine on their appetizing dishes, the kettle boy works busily in one corner of the room. He is filling his kettles with the tea that he is going to serve to diners. After the kettles are full of tea, it is time to get down to business. He goes around the restaurant filling the guest cups with tea. But he never serves the tea in an ordinary way.
I try to give pleasure to the people who come to this restaurant.
He spins the kettles with ease and performs tricks. And it isn't long until he manages to draw the attention of the diners. The main job of the kettle boy is to go around the restaurant looking for empty cups to fill with tea. Finally, he finds a place to show off his skills. And he fills the diner's cup with the long spout of the tea kettle in a flash. The tea kettle that he uses is definitely different from normal tea kettles. The especially long spout is an incredible 1 meter and 40 centimeters long. At one time, kettle boys were so popular that you could find them in every restaurant. But now things are different. It is only because of foreign tourists that kettle boys can't continue their trade. Almost all the kettle boys who used to perform difficult tricks are gone, and there are only a few left. He twists his body like a gymnast and incorporates various kung fu moves into his tricks. His skill of filling cups that are far away doesn't fail in drawing gasps of amazement.
Instead of just eating, I like having the kettle boy around. It makes me feel like I'm being extra special.
The tricks he performs makes the tea taste even better.
Because Chinese food is especially greasy, the people here have made it a habit of washing the grease down with tea. This is the setting in which the kettle boy first appeared. And although this occupation is at a decline, there are still people who want to learn its skills.
I'll give it a try.
But isn't it easy to learn the skill that takes years of hard work and sweat to master? The only way to learn how to aim the nozzle of a tea kettle precisely at a small teacup and fill it is by practice.
It isn't as easy as I thought.
You have to focus and only think of the teacup.
On one of his few days off, the kettle boy decides to go out. He has a tea kettle in one hand. We wonder what he's doing with it on a day that he doesn't work. In a moment, he arrives at a specialty tea kettle store.
There are a lot of places to fix. Take a look over here. I had this welded, but it already has a hole.
Because the tea kettle is over 3 years old, it has many places that need to be fixed. He wishes that he could afford a new one, but because of his small income, he knows that he has to stick with his old tea kettle. The store is full of new tea kettles, but for him, they are too expensive. But in the corner, he finds a kettle that he likes, and out of habit, he gives it a spin.
This is a new product. It's sleek and nice and also very light.
No matter how much he wants it, his monthly income is only the equivalent of $100, and there is no way that he can afford to buy this tea kettle that amounts to a tenth of his monthly income.
Of course, this new kettle is expensive, but that's not all. I've grown quite attached to my old one.
For the kettle boy, who started when he was 17 years old and has been at it for the past 5 years, practice is the only way that he'll improve his skill and his life. As the many kettle boys disappear, there was a time when he was in danger of having to leave his occupation. But now he draws much attention as a person with a very rare skill and occupation. When people see him practice, there is always a curious onlooker who wants to try it for himself. But it isn't easy to fill the cup with a kettle.
This is much more difficult than it looks. I thought I could do it, but my stiff body won't let me take the proper position. And I can't see the teacup very well either.
How long are you going to do this job?
Although it's difficult, I'm going to focus on this and do it for a very long time.
These are people who have extraordinary lives that are different from everyone else. And that's why they draw so much attention. Hidden within their special lives are special difficulties that no one else can understand. We can see another unique view of life through the lives that these people lead.
We'll show you unusual and strange cooking implements from around the world. We'll show you the unusual rice jar cooker of Sri Lanka. Also, we'll show you a giant pot and guitar that could cook 100 servings of rice. Plus, we'll show you traditional earthenware pots from Morocco. We'll see exciting kitchenware, which will double your pleasure and fun. Let us reveal to you kitchens around the world that draw attention with clever ideas. In each country and each kitchen, there are many cooking implements that draw attention. This implement that we might have seen somewhere in a mill is a gigantic blender that is used to grind vegetables and grain. This is a rice rinsing machine that you can find in most households in Egypt. And this is a giant pot with handles for opening and closing. Also, there is a machine for juicing vegetables and fruit. But that's not all. There is also a unique knife in Sri Lanka. You can cut your ingredients with the blade even without cutting a board.
This is a kitchen knife called the pihir, and with this you can cut just about anything.
You can cut your ingredients with the blade even without a cutting board.
We use this in our house, especially when we cut fish. I step on this section like this to secure it, and then I cut it down.
There is the pihiha in Sri Lanka. There is also the kitchen knife called mezaluna in Egypt, which is also known as the crescent knife for its shape. The mezzaluna has a curved blade that can easily cut a large amount of vegetables. There is also a stone that is used to grind vegetables and seasonings for cuisine.
This stone grinds quite well. You can grind just about anything with it.
It grinds the ingredients while maintaining their aroma. Now, why don't we visit the small country of Sri Lanka, located in the south of India. The average temperature here is a hot 27 degrees, and because it rains all year long, while maintaining summer-like weather, it is possible to harvest rice 3 times a year. This is the reason that you can see yellow ripe rice and young green rice at the same time here. And because of this, the staple of the diet here is rice.
Welcome! Something special about our rice? Well, if there's anything special, it would have to be this jar.
The jar that the lady showed us is a traditional Sri Lankan earthenware jar called mutia. This is the most popular cooking implement amongst the housewives of this country. So, how do they cook the rice in this country, where it is a staple of the diet?
We wash the rice in this container. It's quite easy and you can remove the pebbles easily.
At first glance, the bowl that the rice is being washed in, along with the way the woman is washing the rice, is quite similar to other countries in Asia. It reminds us of the olden days when rice came with pebbles still in it. The woman who washes the rice with skill seems to have managed to remove the petals.
Well, the rice is cooked differently in restaurants. I'll show you. Follow me.
Now the rice is put in mutia, along with the proper amount of water, and it is cooked over a fire.
Oh, you have to keep on mixing the rice as it boils. This takes a lot of skill.
They say that in restaurants, they have an unusual way of cooking rice. The method of cooking rice here is with this long spatula. When the rice seems to be cooked to a certain degree, it is taken out and strained. Instead of letting the rice sit after cooking, as people do in the other Asian countries, they strain the water from the cooked rice. This is the Sri Lankan way of cooking rice.
Mmm, it's fragrant.
Because Sri Lankan rice isn't very sticky, it is cooked with the lid open in order to let the moisture evaporate. This is the way they cook rice in the Sri Lankan earthenware pot called the mutia. This is the desert country of Qatar, located in the east of the Arabian Peninsula. For a long time, lambs were the only way to maintain a livelihood for the people of Qatar, who were members of the nomadic tribes. This is the reason why quite a number of dishes using lamb meat were developed here. There is a container here that is used exclusively for cooking lamb. We visited a store that sells pots and pans in the marketplace. There were many pots stacked and lined up neatly in front of the store.
Come, take a look inside.
With the guide of the owner, we were able to see a giant plate as well as this. Now what is it?
This is called the zeta. There's room for three adults in here.
To find out the use of the zeta, we visited a food production factory in the city. You could see the zeta here as well. So what are these giant pots used for?
Oh, these pots are indispensable when cooking lamb. Take a look. You can cook five lambs in here at once.
It is a long-standing tradition here in Qatar to cook lambs whole. Lambs are usually eaten in large feasts or used for religious rituals. Those are the times when the zeta is used. Although it is difficult to cook lambs in the zeta because of its size, it is one of the most popular dishes here.
Oh, there's no way you can make this food with any other pot. Oh, you need the zeta in order to cook lambs whole and make them taste good.
Morocco is a beautiful country located on the northwest tip of the African continent. It is 446,550 square kilometers in size and has 31 million people living in its beautiful exotic land. They also have a famous pot here. Tajins are earthenware pots that come in a variety of different sizes and colors.
Most households have one or two of these. If your household doesn't have one, you're probably not Moroccan.
The tajin is the most representative pot of Morocco. Now, what could it be used for?
Oh, this? This is used to cook food. But it isn't used to cook just any kind of food. It's used to cook traditional Moroccan food.
The tajin, which has a conical lid, is a shallow earthenware pan. It is usually used to steam food and maintains the nutrition and flavor of the ingredients well. The tajin is so popular here that if you go to the small Moroccan city of Safi, you can see one that is 6 meters in diameter.
They say that this was made about 5 years ago to cook food for festivals.
Now why don't we find out how the tajin, which has been used for many centuries here, is used to cook food.
I'll cook a delicious dish using a tajin.
The fish is prepared and cleaned. Then a traditional Moroccan seasoning is applied onto the inside and outside of the fish. Then it is placed on the tajin along with tomatoes. Dishes made from the tajin tend to be tender and have a strong flavor. And to the Moroccans, it is a traditional foods that remind them of home. Now we are curious about the taste of the tajin fish cuisine that was made with so much care. The savory fish that was cooked in the tajin takes a long time to cool, and this is why you can enjoy the dish hot for a long time.
It tastes great whenever I eat it. I love its chewy and spicy taste.
I think dishes cooked with tajin turn out delicious no matter what.
Now, after traveling 30 minutes by car from the center of the city, we arrive at a private residence. They say that there is a different kind of tajin here.
This is called a danjia and is a little different in shape from the tajin. If you use this, the food will be as delicious as cooked in a tajin.
Another indispensable kitchen implement for Moroccan homes is the tanjia. It is a pot made with Moroccan clay, which is famous for its stickiness. The tanjia, which is made by using the same method by hand that was used for thousands of years, doesn't break easily and insulates the heat of the food well. To make cuisine with a tanjia, first meat is placed into the long earthenware pot. Then a traditional Moroccan seasoning made using cinnamon, ginger, and ground pepper is added. Afterwards, the mouth is covered with paper.
By covering this with paper instead of using a lid, you can let the steam out and prevent the pot from boiling over. Now, why don't we go to cook the food? Follow me.
Unexpectedly, the woman leads us to the neighborhood public bathhouse and hands the tanjia to a staff member who takes it downstairs.
This is where we heat the water for the baths. We used a wood fire to heat the water, so we always have the best charcoal here.
He places some hot charcoal onto some ash and places the tanjia on it to complete a makeshift fireplace.
You have to heat the tanjia in this way. This is a traditional way to cook with a tanjia.
The food is much more delicious when it's cooked slowly over charcoal like this.
Because the tanjia is made from clay, it has the distinctive feature of making meat tender and letting seasoning soak into the food the longer you cook it. Now it is time for the entire family to gather around and eat the delicious food cooked with the tanjia.
Oh, the meat is so tender. It melts in your mouth.
Oh, the tanjia is one of the most basic factors in the taste of Moroccan food. It's delicious.
The kitchen is a place where delicious dishes of the world are cooked. Each country and each household has unique and unusual cooking implements to suit their tastes and needs. In each kitchen, you'll find the simple yet individual charm of each culture.